Hello everyone and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we're going to walk you through the latest updates to teamwork and intelligent productivity experiences in Microsoft 365, including the new hub for teamwork, Microsoft Teams, which now includes guest access, telephony, and Outlook calendar integration, and also new intelligent capabilities across the Office desktop apps. But before we get started, please give me a warm welcome for Kirk Koenigsbauer, CVP of Office.
Hey.
It's great to be here.
Thanks for having me.
So we've just heard about a lot of Microsoft 365 powered device news just a few minutes ago. And these are devices that really take advantage of the latest controls in terms of simplifying management, delivering up-to-date security, but we also enable teamwork and creativity. Now, we just looked at all the management and the deployment capabilities. Why don't we focus for this one on the user experiences that we're enabling through Microsoft 365? So
sounds good.
Why don't you walk us through the modernized teamwork experiences and creativity that we can get through Microsoft 365?
Sure. So first, thanks for having me. And again, just to maybe a little bit of context, Microsoft 365, the whole goal is to bring together the best of Office, the best of Windows, the best of EMS into a single service that's complete, that delivers these kinds of experiences for teamwork and for productivity. We're really pivoting in a pretty big way to make this not just a marketing bundle, but really a fundamental shift in how we're going to design software, build software, plan together, and support these services and offerings. Our overall strategy is really focused on two key things. First is, again, delivering that end user delight that you're talking about, which we'll focus in this session. And then second, it's delivering those experiences on a secure infrastructure with the highest level of TCO that we can possibly deliver. That's kind of what we're here to do today.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, so today let's talk about what we're going to go do on the creativity and the teamwork side. There's a bunch of things that I'll show you in a few minutes, but I think I want to pull out and just talk about a couple things. One is that we're really going to infuse artificial intelligence into the experiences to help people be more creative, to help people be more impactful. That's in terms of delivering high impact content, in terms of automating routine tasks, in terms of surfacing insights out of their content that they have. That's what we're focused on. The next thing that you'll see we'll focus on is a bunch around new user experiences. And here we're going to take advantage of things like ink, using the stylus, voice, new gestures, new touch capabilities, introducing new kinds of content like video, and then three-dimensional kinds of content. There's just a lot there. And the last point I guess I just mentioned is we're fully committed to delivering Microsoft 365 across all platforms on all devices. And we're going to intelligently connect all these together using the Microsoft Graph and things like Office 365 groups.
All right, but let's make this all real. I bet everybody here wants to see a few awesome demos.
Yes, so demos.
How do we bring all this together with Microsoft Teams?
Great. So first of all, what I'll do is I'll show you a quick demo of Teams for folks that haven't seen it before. I'll pop it up here. And the great thing about Teams is that essentially what it allows you to do is bring together both conversations and content into a single canvas, sort of a single interface where you can start your work. It's not the only place collaboration and teamwork will happen, but it's certainly a great starting point. And on the left side of the screen, just to orient you on it, you see the different teams that I'm a part of: deployment group, commercial rollout, operations, deployment script repository. And then underneath them, there's different channels essentially for conversations that I might want to go have. On the right side of the screen, if you look, you'll see all the different conversations that are going on right now with all the different team members in those groups. And these are persistent, threaded chats. As I sort of scroll through them here, you can see there's not only conversations that happen, but content integrated right into it. So for example, let me scroll down a little bit. You can see, for example, there's a link here to an Excel file. So what's great about this is you can infuse the conversation that you've got with, say, a Word doc or an Excel doc or a PowerPoint doc or whatever it might be, and you can have it right in that experience. Everybody's provisioned. Everybody has access to it. There's no sort of running around and hunting for the particular file. It's all right there for everybody in the team.
Now you can even edit from Teams.
There's all kinds of different kinds of content types, though. It's not just conversations. It's not just docs. If I go through this here, you can see there's, for example, code snippets. You can have video content here. You can have all sorts of different kinds of content types. The other thing you'll notice too is it's, again, not just conversations. There are specific tabs that you see at the top of the page here. And you can customize these and have first and third party tabs. It's all up to you. But for example, I've got a SharePoint or a OneDrive file tab here that's got all the files that this particular team's working on. If you're taking team notes together, all that stuff can be right here for everybody. Maybe the team has a Power BI dashboard that they're working on. You can bring that right into the team's experience as well. And these are not just sort of static links. These are actually interactive. So for example, I can go and click around on this dashboard, and hopefully you guys can see it sort of change as I'm tapping around through it. And there's a whole gallery of different ways that you could add web parts, Word docs, content from Stream, from Trello, from Wrike, from many other third parties available there. We've got 100 different kinds of integrations you can go do.
And we've heard since day one, and we've been covering this on Microsoft Mechanics since kind of the preview and into the GA, what about people that are working outside of the organization, outside of my tenant? They want to be able to maybe get their business partners or vendors in. How do we engage then with those folks that are on the virtual team effectively, maybe outside of my org ID?
Totally right. Just this summer, we introduced access for external guests. And so folks from outside of the organization or outside of your firewall can essentially now participate in Microsoft Teams just like any other team member.
And we made some really exciting announcements just today in terms of Skype for Business and Teams. Can you tell us more about what's behind that?
Yeah, there's a lot going on in terms of our intelligent communication strategy that we have. Essentially, what we're trying to do is infuse these concepts of artificial intelligence, things like cognitive services for translation, for transcription, for speech recognition, and so forth, and bringing them in to essentially create better voice experiences, better meeting experiences, better calling experiences, all to bring that together. You're starting to see some of these capabilities show up inside of Microsoft Teams now. On the screen, for example, I tapped on the calling tab over on the left. This gives me a place to get all my contacts, but I can go ahead and make a phone call here if I want to, either inside of my organization or outside of my organization.
Right, you got the dial pad. That's basically all you need. So apart from that, we've also made some updates in terms of meetings and the integration there with Outlook and everything else, right?
That's right. Yeah, meetings are now also integrated into the Teams Canvas itself. And so on the left, you can see I've got pulled from Exchange and from the Microsoft Graph. I've got all my calendar items here for the day, a particular meeting I could go and join if I wanted to here. But one thing I'll show you as well is that we're integrating the meetings actually into the Canvas experience too, in the sense of, let's say the meeting has already happened. Of course, it's been recorded because there's a bunch of people that were on it. You can see on the conversation canvas here, the meeting is actually integrated into the flow. So if I want to go watch that, I'll just go tap on this tab. I've already got it open here. But you can see it pops up essentially a Microsoft Stream video here. I can go and play this. I'll just tap on it here. But this gives me a playback of the entire meeting itself. And look over on the right side of the screen, you'll see there's actually a translation that's happening as well, or a transcription, I should say, that's happening as well. And so that's a great way to, frankly, have automated meeting notes, essentially. You know, you've got all that stuff right there for you. So it's a pretty good experience, and we have a lot of innovation we think we can roll into this.
And Stream's really great. If you haven't catched the episode that we did with Vishal Sood, he goes into depth on all of that.
Great.
But all of this, the great thing with Teams is all of it's integrated with things like SharePoint, OneDrive for Business on the back end, so you get all of the kind of all the integration plus all of the IT controls.
Absolutely, you got it.
So beyond these Microsoft Teams and kind of what we can do there and the integration and what we just saw in the browser, we've also done a bunch in terms of being able to work with, you know, our rich client apps. So Teams looks like it's going to improve the way that we work about, you know, in terms of our teams, but you mentioned AI, and I'm not a designer. I'd prefer to be writing, you know, PS1 files and scripts and PowerShell. So how do you help me then make myself a bit more designer and aesthetic friendly in terms of building great slides?
Yeah. No, when we talk about helping people be more creative, we don't just talk about designers and the like. We really do talk about everyone inside of an organization to help them unlock their ingenuity and their creativity. And we think AI can do a lot, particularly infused into the office applications. So let me give you a couple of different examples here. I'll go ahead and start in Word. And I'll just start with some work that we're doing to use AI and machine learning around inking. And so, you know, when you take a step and think back, the Office applications were built 30 years ago for really sort of a fixed layout, paper-based, or in the case of, say, PowerPoint, a slide-oriented format, 35-millimeter slides.
Right.
We really want to modernize that. And with all the particularly the modern devices, like this Surface Pro device here, you know, you can really do some pretty compelling things with ink. And so let me just give you a couple of different examples. You know, the idea here is I can just pick up my pen, and I can immediately just start writing here on the screen itself. I can circle things if I want to. I can annotate. I can make comments and so forth. There's tools here, not just pens, but you've got things like highlighters. So watch as I go and I highlight this paragraph. I'll do it sort of crooked on purpose. And you'll see what'll end up happening is Word automatically senses that. It uses AI to detect what part of the paragraph I was, selects the whole thing, and highlights it for me. It's a really nice capability, as you can see. I'll want to just show you another example of that, too. Let's say I want to make some annotations here. I'm not so happy about this particular line. I'll just strike through it. And as I strike through it, you'll see it'll just disappear. It just goes away. This is an example of using new gestures using the stylus here and incorporating that into Word itself. And you know, we also have the capability to do things like shape recognition as well. So if I draw a triangle there or a box, you get the idea here. It'll go ahead and convert those automatically for me on the screen. So lots of cool AI capability infused right into Word.
Very cool, and it's interacting with the underlying text there in that case, doing all of the things that you would want to be able to do if you had paper, for example.
That's right. And it renders across all devices as well. So I can start here, but open it up on my iPad, my iPhone, whatever it might be, and it'll work just great.
And you also mentioned images earlier, and I know that a lot of us maybe want to be able to present our ideas, and using tools like PowerPoint or doing great presentations. Actually, let's stay in Word for a second, because I think we got some more stuff.
Great.
So you've done some other things that we can do in terms of connecting to various cloud services to make us better authors as well, right?
That's right. Yeah, so again, we're using AI to help people with their writing. Word's always been great as a canvas for getting your thoughts down. It's always had things like spell checking and grammar checking. But now with the power of the cloud, we can use machine learning over the content that folks have, and we can literally help them be better writers. So let me give you a few examples here. In this table, we've got some interesting examples of writing that people do that probably could be improved upon. So for example, here's an example of worriedness and redundancy. For the purpose of going to the meeting, I left early. Watch now as if you hover over, you see the notion of golden squiggles as opposed to just red squiggles, or even better, golden squiggles. And as I hover over here, Word will go ahead and correct that automatically for me and just compress that sentence down. Or for example, informal language. They are going to go bananas over Microsoft, over Office 365. Maybe they should just say go wild. Or double negation, one of my favorite. I did not see nothing. You really want to write, I did not see anything. And as you can see, Word is just going and fixing up this document here for me. Passive voice. They were quickly caught by the police. The police quickly caught them. Some things, too, that are just not just about grammar, but also helping people be more inclusive in their writing so that others, when they read it, you know, are going to be more interested in it and find it easier to relate to. So for example, gender-specific language is something that we obviously want to avoid. The airline is hiring more stewardesses. How about the airline is hiring more flight attendants? Or age bias, we need some young blood on the team. How about we need some new people on the team? So hopefully you get the idea here that Word can trap for these things and help you with your writing.
Okay, now the one I've been dying to see.
I've got to see images and I've got to see
PowerPoint. So no. You mentioned all of this earlier. I know that we're all wanting to build PowerPoints out for the various jobs that we do.
Yeah.
And how do we infuse kind of design language into this and make ourselves better?
No, that's for sure. So yeah, I assume you know, your slides look a lot like my slides sometimes, where
got
this white background and black text on top of it. And talk about really a great example of AI is the work that the PowerPoint team has done around this new feature called PowerPoint Designer. Let me give you a couple of different examples. One here, I've got this slide. It's super basic. Maybe I want to go drop some pictures into it. I'm going to select these pictures that are here. Insert them. And when you first look at the slide, it goes, yep, that's what PowerPoint typically does. It just stacks them up on top of each other. And of course, you have to go and rejigger them to make it look good. But look over to the right. With Designer, there are now suggestions. And so what's happening is the content literally is being looked at from our cloud service. We machine learn over thousands and thousands of templates to go and create a better looking slide for you. And in fact, there's a bunch of different options I can choose from here. I'll just scroll through a couple of them. You don't have to do anything. PowerPoint, in this particular case, reorients the pictures. It uses salient region detection to know where the person's face is so it doesn't crop that person out of the picture. It applies this nice template. It actually picks up the color scheme of the pictures and uses that to identify which templates you should go and use. And we've got a bunch of different examples of this. So for example, I can go through this slide deck here. Again, basic text, maybe an image. You know, that looks like such a better way to go and present that slide. This one's a fun one. It's got a bunch of times on it. It's actually a timeline, as you can see. Again, PowerPoint Designer creates these really, really cool looking visualizations instead of the static text I have. And this is really live PowerPoint. This is actually just SmartArt objects that we've been able to render here. So you can go in and change all those if you'd like. And then maybe one last example here. This is more of a flowchart-oriented thing where PowerPoint identifies. There's actually verbs at the start of each one of those sentences. And it goes and smart enough to sort of pull out and create these really magical slides, I think.
How quick that was, because you just had that open for about 30 seconds,
totally.
All the images, everything. Even if you could format it and had the right aesthetic kind of look and,
totally.
And feel, that's just saved you a ton of time.
Absolutely.
But beyond that, we've also done a bunch of stuff in terms of being able to work with images in 3D is a big thing now.
Right.
Why don't you show us what's new there?
I mentioned video content. I mentioned three-dimensional. Let me show you an example of 3D type content. In the Office applications, we're taking advantage of a lot of the work the Windows team has done around 3D objects and 3D content that you can integrate into your work. This is a pretty simple slide here that's got this picture of an Xbox controller. But if I actually select this controller, it's literally a three-dimensional object that you can see here on the screen. I can rotate it, spin it around, and so forth. Maybe I want to resize it. You can go ahead and do that here if you'd like. And I can put it anywhere on the screen, of course. And it gives that nice sort of visual feel. You can take that three-dimensional capability and then do something that people love to do in PowerPoint, which is to have sort of transition and animation-oriented effects. But right. those can be really hard to do if you want to create that motion. So I'll show you a quick example here where I can take this object, and let's say I want to sort of have it fly all over the place through my presentation. Maybe I'll pick it up here, I'll move it. Maybe I want to make it a little bit smaller on this part of the page. And maybe I want to rotate it a little bit differently. And then on this page, I'll paste it back in here. I want it to go big again. I wanted to rotate it though, so it's really from the top. And then lastly, on this one, I want it to be smaller. And again, I'll just maybe stick it in the upper right corner. And then taking advantage of another feature in PowerPoint called Morph, when I go and play these, watch how automatically all the, hopefully you guys can see them on the screen, all the transitions are done automatically for me. And watch as the object rotates, it moves across the screen in the order that I want it to go do it. I mean, this would have taken somebody hours to go do in the old days using PowerPoint. But now, using these AI-based capabilities, it really creates a nice experience.
Right, this is something that I'm personally using almost every single day in terms of Morph, not only for 3D, but also 2D images. So those were a couple of updates to PowerPoint, but I know a lot of people watching are probably curious about what's new in Excel with data. And we made some announcements recently about Excel being able to handle different data types. Can you tell us what's new there?
You bet. So Excel, for folks that have been around for the last 30 years, basically it had two data types, text and numbers. And that's been great, but we're expanding our footprint here to do some different things going forward. This is a simple example of where I've got some stocks. If I just click on that little icon here, let's say I want to look at the actual price. I'll go and just select that, and it sucks it out of the Microsoft Cloud and brings it right into my spreadsheet for me. I don't have to type it myself. I don't have to copy and paste it from other location. It just brings it there automatically for me. And in fact, I can just go ahead and start typing things. So if I want the low price, I can do that. Or maybe I want the high price, I can do that. Or maybe I want to go and add another stock. Starbucks would be good. I'm feeling like I need a little coffee right now. How about that? I'll go type that in there. It goes and pulls and extracts that information right out of the cloud, puts it right into my spreadsheet. So really, really powerful capability.
Amazing. Connected all the different data sources outside of Excel there and outside the local machine.
Yep.
So really great tour in terms of some of the end user experiences that we can expect with Microsoft 365 across Teams and the Office apps. But what's next on the horizon? Where are we gonna what are we gonna do next? How do people stay up to date with all the updates as well?
Yeah, for sure. So this past summer we introduced Microsoft 365 to our commercial customers with Microsoft 365 Enterprise, and we also had a small business offering. Today we're announcing Microsoft 365 Education, which is going to bring enhancements specific to teacher and classroom-oriented experiences. We're also introducing a new offering called Microsoft 365 F1, which is essentially for first-line workers. These are folks that are service employees, retail employees, branch associates. They really represent the backbone of many, many companies in terms of the industry, but they've been largely left behind by the technology and digital transformation that we've got. So we're in creating tailored, specific offerings for these particular kinds of employees, and we expect to be able to deliver great productivity and value for them.
So all of that, plus all the different updates that we're making, you are the author of the monthly blog as well, so that's probably something else that we should point out. Be sure to stay tuned to Office Blogs at blogs.office.com. And also, thank you, Kirk. We've learned a lot here today in terms of all the different things that we can do across Microsoft 365, demonstrating the latest tech. And of course, you can keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for all the latest updates in Office and beyond. We'll see you next time.
Great, thanks.